Since the start of the space age, more than 8,800 objects have been launched into Earth's orbit. But in a few years, that number could increase significantly. Private companies plan to launch tens of thousands of satellites into space to beam internet to customers on Earth. Elon Musk's SpaceX alone has announced plans to launch 42,000 satellites as part of its Starlink internet project. If this happens, SpaceX will, by itself, be responsible for about a fivefold increase in the number of spacecraft launched by all of humanity. Technically, a satellite refers to any object that orbits another, larger object in space, like the Earth orbiting the Sun. But when we talk about satellites, we usually think about man-made satellites. The first man-made satellite launched into space was called Sputnik, and it was about the size of a beach ball.
This is Russia on October 4th, 1957. On the launching pad is Sputnik Zemlya First, freely translated to mean traveling companion to the Earth. The Soviet Union is launching the first Earth satellite.
Sputnik signaled the beginning of the space race, and since then, we've been launching more and more objects into orbit. Now, companies such as SpaceX, Amazon, Telesat, and OneWeb want to launch thousands of satellites to make what they call mega constellations.
A mega constellation is a network that has hundreds or even thousands of satellites all orbiting and working together in a complete system. The reason that these companies are pursuing these mega constellations comes down to essentially two factors. One is that the cost of hardware for these types of satellites has come down and they've shrunk in size considerably. And the second is because there's an increasing demand for data all around the world. So providing high-speed data to any point on Earth is an increasingly valuable asset.
Satellites that provide internet are not necessarily a new idea. Companies like Hughes Network Systems and Viasat are already beaming internet to rural parts of the planet that are not served by fiber or cable connections. About 49% of global households are still not connected to the internet. And these are the people that traditional satellite companies have tried to reach.
Today, there are only a small number of consumer internet offerings over satellite. They tend to be more expensive, and they also tend to have fairly low numbers of users. In the United States, there are only about 2 million customers out of our more than 100 million households that utilize satellite internet.
One big issue with current satellite networks has been latency.
Traditional satellites orbit very far away from the Earth, and that distance increases the overall latency in the network. Latency is the responsiveness of the network. So if you're streaming something online, it's how quickly something loads or how smoothly it runs.
Most internet satellites today operate in what's called geostationary orbit, which is around 36,000 kilometers above Earth's surface, and remain fixed on top of one area. But the satellite systems that SpaceX, OneWeb, Amazon, and Telesat are proposing will operate in what is called low Earth orbit, or between 180 and 2,000 kilometers above Earth's surface. In theory, this should cut down on the latency issues, with speeds up to 20 times faster than current GEO satellites. But to get the same coverage with LEO satellites, you need more of them.
The speed of transmission of light in fiber is 40% slower than it is in air or vacuum. So, in fact, you can build a quite extensive low Earth orbit satellite network and have very fast communications capability.
Because they're lower, you actually need more of them to cover an effective area, right? They just can't see all the parts of the Earth. So our higher orbiting satellites used to be able to get away with a much smaller number of actual orbiting vehicles, whereas these new low Earth orbit constellations do require more. However, there's more to it than that. They also need to have adequate power, and if they're going to provide lots of people with connectivity, they need to have lots of capacity. Hence, you need more satellites to do that. Whether having 10, 20,000 or more satellites orbiting is warranted for any of these is still yet to be seen.
Satellites still need something back on Earth to receive their signals.
Beyond building the satellites for these mega constellations, these companies will also have to invest in heavy amounts of infrastructure on the ground. That will look like thousands or even millions of antennae all around the world to receive the signal from the satellites and distribute it to consumers on the ground. Plans to offer internet from space may sound familiar, as both Facebook and Google have considered developing these kinds of satellites before. But Facebook hasn't announced anything in over a year since talking about its Athena satellite, And Google is one of the main investors in SpaceX's system, so they're expected to look very closely at how Starlink is developed. The top companies pursuing mega constellations are tech giants SpaceX and Amazon, as well as satellite builders OneWeb and Telesat. The leader in this category, at least by quantity of satellites launched, is SpaceX, as they've launched 120 of their Starlink satellites so far this year and are set to launch another 60 very soon.
And we have confirmation of deploy. You can hear the team in the background. This is an incredible moment for SpaceX. You can see those flat-packed Starlink satellites slowly gliding away from the top of the second stage. This is the highest number of satellites that SpaceX has ever deployed in a single time.
SpaceX's utilization of its renewable Falcon 9 rocket dramatically decreases the cost of sending satellites into space. FCC documents show that SpaceX expects Starlink to become operational once at least 800 satellites are deployed.
The main value of Starlink is providing low latency, high bandwidth access to sparse and moderately sparse, relatively low density areas. It's probably able to serve like 3 to 5% of people in the world.
SpaceX began with the idea to launch 12,000 satellites, but in October 2019, the company requested permission for an additional 30,000. SpaceX has also put in a request with the FCC for up to 1 million Earth stations, which end-user customers will utilize to communicate with its satellites. The U.S. Air Force is also testing Starlink satellites on its military planes and has so far reported favorable results. SpaceX has said that it will begin offering internet service by 2020.
Hot on SpaceX's heels is OneWeb, which is already building its own satellites, having launched 6 earlier this year.
We've done a joint venture with Airbus, and we have a factory at Cape Canaveral, and we've really set up a supply chain, and we're using the same satellite over and over again to populate our system. And you know, we're gonna produce 650 for the first layer of capacity, which will be for global coverage, but we'll go all the way up to 2,000.
Like SpaceX, OneWeb has its own set of big name backers, including SoftBank and British business magnate Richard Branson. OneWeb says each of its satellites cost about $1 million to produce. But unlike SpaceX, OneWeb must depend on Russian-built Soyuz rockets to launch its satellites.
Unlike OneWeb and SpaceX, Amazon has yet to launch any satellites and is early in developing as it's still seeking regulatory approval for its Project Kuiper network.
Amazon's Project Kuiper plans to launch a total of 3,236 satellites into low Earth orbit. Back in April 2019, Amazon hired the former leader of SpaceX's satellite program to run Project Kuiper after Musk fired him. According to reports, Musk had become frustrated with the pace of Starlink's development. Though it's behind on building satellites, Amazon already has a head start on ground infrastructure. In November 2019, the company announced AWS Ground Station, a new business unit that will build 12 satellite facilities around the world to provide the vital link needed to transmit data to and from satellites in orbit. Plus, although technically a different company, Jeff Bezos's Blue Origin would be the obvious choice to launch these satellites.
Also in the mix is Canadian satellite builder Telesat, which has received significant investment thus far, but hasn't launched any satellites yet. They're negotiating with companies that would build their network, which is estimated to cost about $3 billion.
Astronomers are now very concerned about this new large constellations that are being launched. The number that are planned would exceed all satellites launched to date. And the real challenge here is not necessarily the number of new launches, it's the brightness, how bright these things will be, that they will saturate our detectors and cause all sorts of difficulties in astronomical observing.
This image, taken from a telescope in Chile in November 2019, illustrates the concerns from astronomers. The telescope, meant to see images of distant stars and galaxies, instead captured the light trails of 19 Starlink satellites. Some astronomers took to Twitter to express their concerns after SpaceX launched the first 60 Starlink satellites back in May 2019.
After astronomers raised these concerns, SpaceX CEO Elon Musk said in a tweet that his company would look at how they can decrease the brightness of these Starlink satellites.
SpaceX President Gwynne Shotwell also told reporters in December 2019 that they plan to address the issue. SpaceX will put a special coating on the bottom of one of the satellites on its third launch to test if that will decrease the satellite's brightness.
We have monthly telecons with SpaceX engineers to discuss these things. The LSST project in Chile also has another set of telecons with them on a regular basis to try to address these issues. There's been no action taken yet, but you know, we're hopeful that something will change. The company says that they're committed to keeping the night sky dark.
These satellites could also impact radio astronomy. In a statement following the first launch of Starlink satellites, the International Astronomical Union summarized their concerns, saying, "Despite notable efforts to avoid interfering with radio astronomy frequencies, aggregate radio signals emitted from the satellite constellations can still threaten astronomical observations at radio wavelengths. Recent advances in radio astronomy, such as producing the first image of a black hole, or understanding more about the formation of planetary systems, were only possible through concerted efforts in safeguarding the radio sky from interference." Another major concern is debris. This is summarized by a theory called the Kessler syndrome, which posits that when two objects collide in space, they generate more debris that then collides with other objects, creating even more shrapnel and litter until the entirety of Earth's lower orbit is impassable. This hypothetical scenario came to life in February of 2009, when an inactive Russian communications satellite, Cosmos 2251, collided with an active commercial communications satellite operated by US-based Iridium Satellite. The incident produced around 2,000 pieces of debris. Debris is particularly important considering that SpaceX, OneWeb, and Amazon have all said that their satellites would have a lifespan of only 5 to 7 years, which is about half the lifespan of traditional satellites. When the companies are finished with the satellites or they fail in orbit, they plan to deorbit them, which means that the satellites would be intentionally pushed back into the Earth's atmosphere, where they would burn up during reentry.
One of the key questions facing this industry is who regulates these mega constellations? And that's a gray area.
We don't have a mandate to approve or reject any space activity of any sovereign government or of any company. Companies are under the jurisdiction of the state in which they're located. And it's incumbent upon those states to put in place a system of authorization and continuing supervision.
In the United States, the authority to regulate these satellites falls largely on the Federal Communications Commission. The FCC is in charge of radio frequency distribution and mitigating any debris that may result from these satellites. Under Ajit Pai, the FCC has been eager to work with these companies.
At a 1.6 million foot view, you might say, we see an industry that is changing quickly in space, and we are trying to make sure that our regulations change with it. A Byzantine licensing and regulatory approval system could be a bottleneck that hurts consumers and innovators alike. And that makes a difference because now a satellite can be built in a matter of months or weeks or even days in some cases and launched by a private provider on demand. And that's why under my leadership, the FCC has been committed to matching the tempo of the industry that we regulate. Our space agenda involves cutting red tape and giving green lights.
In the same speech, Pai promised that the FCC would do a comprehensive review of its orbital debris rules to address recent market developments. Other U.S. regulators also include the Air Force, the FAA, and in some cases, NOAA.
The Air Force maintains the official catalog of objects on orbit that the United States uses to avoid conjunctions and close approaches on orbit. The FAA controls the launch licenses. And if you have a camera looking down on it, then you would need a license from the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, NOAA.
The connectivity market around the world is certainly, you know, well north of $1 trillion. Of course, you have to look at what the addressable market is for each of these companies. They won't be competing very effectively in many cases with your local mobile phone provider or maybe your fiber to the home provider if you're lucky enough to live in one of those areas. But for areas where there aren't a lot of good options, or maybe no options today, this is going to be an attractive opportunity. However, the caution is that there really is a limit to what many people in the world can pay for internet. You know, if you live in an area where you lack clean water or maybe don't have a consistent food supply, having internet service may not be your first priority.
We're going to work first on the verticals where there are people right now willing to pay a lot in airplanes and on boats. And then we're also working with partners, and those partners are governments, and they're also terrestrial mobile operators that want to extend their networks. And then when we think about what we're trying to do as our social mission, which is to connect everyone, I mean, the best sort of line about the company is one web, one world. We want everybody to be connected.
Still, some more established satellite companies are not buying into the hype of low Earth orbit mega constellations. Viasat currently serves around 600,000 residential customers in the U.S. and Europe, and is launching a new geostationary satellite that it expects to be in service globally by 2022.
The reason that we've focused on GEOs is that GEOs seem to be able to deliver more bandwidth and more speed at lower cost, and that's what our end users want. There's also a number of really important risks that are still to be dealt with in the LEO environment. A lot of that is regulatory risk. It's not clear that any individual company or country will be able to scale safely to the number of satellites that are being envisioned. And without that scale, there's a big question about how economically viable these systems will be. And the other really big issue is the geographic distribution of demand. When you do a LEO system, you have to have your satellites distributed according to orbital characteristics, not according to the demand on the ground.
During a media call in May of 2019, Elon Musk estimated that Starlink could bring in revenue of $30 billion a year and would be key to fund his vision of colonizing Mars. Experts agree that estimate is not far-fetched.
We think that the satellite constellations can be tremendously profitable. There's a significant upfront cost to launching the satellite broadband networks, but they are very strong cash generators. So when we think about, you know, Project Kuiper being, you know, tapping into a $100 billion opportunity, you know, we think about that $100 billion opportunity as consumer broadband as a whole, with Project Kuiper, you know, in position to take a slice of that.
People shouldn't be swayed by hearing some seemingly outrageous numbers of individual satellites being launched. Really, we have to keep focused on what are they enabling, what's the business going to be, and what kind of services do they offer to consumers and businesses.